Okay, we're going to pick up here. We're on page 13, and I want to talk to you some about the difference of conviction versus shame from the beautiful story of these two brothers. I've always been drawn to Rembrandt's famous painting that has pictured in it what is obviously the prodigal who's returned home, the wayward son. And he was a master of light, is the light that lands on the father's face. I always love that. Just, Lord bless you and keep you, be kind and gracious to you, make his face shine upon you. And upon his hands, the light's there. That's the focal point of it. Most say that Rembrandt probably was just taking some license here, and they conjecture that the other figure there is the older brother, who we know from the actual parable was not in the house, but or maybe one of the distant figures. And it's a painting that caused Henry Nouwen to become just so fascinated by it that he wrote a book called The Return of the Prodigal. It's really beautiful if you've never read it. But if you remember in the story of these two sons, that what happens is that when this younger comes home, he's expecting to be treated no better than a slave. And yet he is welcomed in, and the father has run to meet him and embraces him and falls upon him with affection. And the older brother stays out in the field working, slaving. And this highlights for me one of the biggest differences between what shame does and what conviction does. When this son, the Bible says, came to his senses, he said, "My father's servants have it better than I do, and I'll return to him." And even though he's saying, "I'm not worthy to be called his son," he still comes back and he calls him father. So in that moment where he comes to his senses, what's actually happening there? What's happening is that he's remembering a better place, a better way, and he's considering the possibility of still being loved and accepted. So what drew him home was the potential kindness of his father. The kindness of God leads to repentance. And so that's the picture of conviction. But shame is personified by the older who just stays outside, never does enter into the celebration. He's never in that embrace. So I put this up here because Rembrandt's picture is very intimate of this son with his head against his father's breast, and the affection, and really what God wants for us is a very intimate experience. Healthy discipline leads to intimacy. Healthy discipline leads to intimacy. And it draws a child in rather than sending a child away. We were never really into much of time out, especially in the sense of go to your room. I always felt like I didn't want to send my children away when they were being disciplined, because it seemed like the message would be, "I can't even stand to look at you right now. I need to get away from you, and I need you to get away from me." So unless things were just so bad that actually we did need to get away from each other, we would try not to do that. I'm not saying that there's not maybe a place for we need to get quiet now, that kind of timeout where we just need to stop this activity and settle in, and you know, you just stay here and be quiet, and we're going to stop this activity or cease from other activities. There may be a place for that, but I think when you send a child to his room, you know, it was kind of the thing. There was a generation. It was like, you just go to your room and you just think about this until you're a better child, and then you can come back out. And I think that's what we don't want to do. And some studies have shown that when children go and they get isolated like that, that's when they start making unhealthy vows. I didn't really want my child left alone with his thoughts at the most vulnerable time. We're trying to instruct them here. And again, I think the process of discipline is designed to build intimacy, not destroy it. There's the picture of the difference of conviction versus shame. Shame always is offering a distant observation. You're not really accepted, so don't think that you're going to get close to the Father. Anything that ever is pushing you away from your Father in heaven, that's not God, right? Okay, the second thing to point to is that conviction is inviting relationship, whereas shame only offers rules. So what healthy discipline does is it's producing heirs of grace rather than slaves to the law. Healthy discipline is producing flourishing human beings, not simply obedient robots. I'm concerned about families where the idea of discipline, and sometimes people are really proud of this, is that everything is a tight ship around here, and it's like a little military camp where everybody says yes, sir, and yes, ma'am, and they might as well salute and say the right things and do the right things, but no relationships being fostered. That's not what the father in this story of these two sons, that's not what he wanted. He didn't want his older son out conforming to all the rules, enslaving in the fields. He wanted a relationship with him. He begged him to come into the party. So simply conforming to all the right things does not mean that we have successfully disciplined our children. We're not trying to produce robots. We're in relationship with them, right? Now, you have to choose what levels of formality that you want in your home. And so, for example, in our home, and I don't know if sure this is right or wrong, but when interacting with other adults, we like for our children to say yes, sir, or yes, ma'am, because we wanted to teach that there's a position of honor. But in interacting with us, as long as we knew there was honor in the home, we did not ask them to answer us yes, sir, yes, ma'am, because I felt like it brought a little bit too much formality that I didn't want. I'm not saying that that's necessarily right or wrong for the home, but in terms of the dynamic that we were trying to create, we're going for relationship. We're not simply trying to have a home where everybody follows the rules. We're not looking for slaves. We're not looking for robots. We don't primarily have servants here. We have children that are heirs, and we have a relationship with them. So you notice this picture and the conviction of the Holy Spirit that comes upon this son. He says, I'm not worthy. Let me be a servant. The father says, oh, no, you're my son. You're my son. A third difference is that conviction shows us that we're sons and daughters despite our sin, whereas what shame does is treats us like slaves, even though we are heirs. Shame is the lie of hell that says you don't measure up, and unless you start measuring up, unless you can do better than you're doing now, you'll never be accepted. The reason it's such a direct lie from the pit of hell is that everything that makes the gospel good and the gospel wonderful is rooted in this assurance. While we were still in our sin, God loved us and Christ came for us. So the truth of heaven is that when you're at your worst, you are still acceptable through the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so what conviction does is assuring us of our place of acceptance despite our sin. But what shame does is it calls into question whether you really are still a son or a daughter and starts treating you as if you're not. So healthy discipline, as following these notes, we're on page 14, assures acceptance rather than withholding it. Everything about discipline that we want to talk about this morning is assuring that you're accepted. Healthy discipline communicates, I'm training you because you're mine. It's not training and saying, I'm punishing you as if I wish you weren't mine. Healthy discipline convinces the child I'm loved even though I disobeyed, rather than because I disobeyed, I feel less loved. I'm trying to show the impact and the power of a healthy discipline process. A fourth thing you notice from the story of these two sons is that how conviction embraces and shame isolates, unable to give and receive love. I just cannot overemphasize this, that we want our children being drawn their heart to our heart. Discipline contributes to this rather than the opposite, which is pushing away. So the sub-points I have here, healthy discipline draws the child towards the parent's heart rather than creating degrees of separation from the parent's love. The number one error that I see in parental discipline is any form of discipline that is communicating either directly or indirectly that because you have misbehaved, I want to be further away from you. And I want you to be further away from me. It is exactly the opposite of what we want our discipline to do. So healthy discipline, second subpoint there, moves towards the disobedient child rather than away. The father ran to meet his disobedient son. Okay. So adopt this, as Anne was saying, about all discipline. This is your teachable moment. This is the moment in which you have a better opportunity to prove your love, right? You do not have to accept behaviors in order to accept persons. And any child at any age knows whether I'm being accepted or whether I'm being rejected. And they can tell the difference in whether you are disciplining my behavior and you're correcting it versus whether you're pushing me away from you.
Shame is effective, so we use it. Shame is effective, so educators use it. Mm-hmm. It is so painful to be shamed, you will curb your behavior quickly if you are afraid of shame. If you have a teacher, you have a parent who's going to shame you, then it will force you. You'll try to follow the rules. You'll try to do the right thing out of fear of shame. It's not an inward change. It's not an eternal change. It's just to follow the rules. It's as soon as I get out from under this, I'm going to do what I want to do. But I want to avoid the shame and the pain. That's not what we want to communicate to our children. We don't want, you know, I see parents who might say the right thing when they discipline, but they show disgust of their child. Oh. You can communicate your disgust of your child. And that disgust is shaming, and therefore they'll wanna do the right thing. But the eternal change that you want to happen in their spirit, it's not going to happen. Actually, the opposite. Yeah. We want to communicate. I'm not an animal person. We may have some people in this room that love animals. I am not an animal person. I'm not, but because I have children, I have become an animal person. I feel like we need to have tadpoles. Okay, we've had just about everything creeping and crawling and running that you can have. And we have had dogs because my children love dogs, my daughter particularly. I am not a dog lover with a capital N-O-T, not a dog lover. But we have a beagle right now. He has major health issues. He has some kind of syndrome that causes him to develop these fatty masses, and these lumps just pop out everywhere on him, and we've aspirated them and we've removed them. And the vet finally said to me, "You're just gonna have a lumpy dog." And we do have this lumpy, he's just one big lump. I love this dog. I love this dog. Now, you may have a beautiful dog. My dog is ugly. But I love this dog because he is mine. I chose to set my affection upon this ugly, lumpy mess. And I love him simply because he is mine. He is not well behaved. He is totally antisocial of other dogs. We cannot walk the dog if we see a dog coming. We have to immediately change our trajectory. If we run into another dog, he turns into a Tasmanian devil. He has major issues. I love this dog because he's mine. That's what we want to communicate to our children in our discipline. That's the opportunity we have, is to say, I love you because you're mine. Period. I love you. Now we're going to deal with this behavior. It does not change the fact you may be lumpy, you may be messy, you may be antisocial. I love you infinitely. And we're going to deal with the behavior.
See, one of the when I was learning about shame years ago, and Lord started healing me of so much, I got thinking about the greyhound dogs at the racetracks that would chase the phony mechanical rabbit that they'd move around in front of it. And that, I thought, in some ways that was a picture of my life, because I wish I were Dr. Doolittle and I could get those greyhounds and say, psst, has anybody noticed that no matter how fast you run, you never get the rabbit? Actually, I read one time in Florida, there's a mechanical failure and the rabbit stopped moving. Could you imagine all those greyhounds' disappointment when they pounced on this wire mesh thing? And but that's what shame does. It is always moving the rabbit of acceptance and love a little further to make you run faster. And you've probably noticed this. There at least be somebody in your life, if you'll run faster in order to try to get love and acceptance, somebody will know that, and somebody will be moving that rabbit on you. And a lot of parents, this is what they basically do, is trying desperately, desperately to get their children to behave, or get their children to try harder, or get their children to do better at school, or get their children to whatever. They know that children will run for love and acceptance. So if you withhold the love and acceptance, then it's going to make them run harder. But what I'm saying is that's the strategy of hell. Because what it does is it produces anxiety in the soul. If I have to run hard to get love, then what if I can't run hard enough? And it just produces anxiety. And when we're anxious, and when we're tired, when we're weary, when we're worried, we're at our worst. We don't want weary, worried kids. We want secure kids, right? So this is, of all the nevers that we have to say about discipline, never, 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 never use love and acceptance as a tool in discipline. Love and acceptance is a given. In fact, the love and acceptance is going to be the thing that's going to build the security in your child's heart. Also, fifth thing here that you'll see in the story of these two sons is how quickly the father moves to the celebration. The son comes back and he doesn't even get all the way through his repentance speech. And the father says, quick, kill the fatted calf and we're going to celebrate. Whereas what shame does is it always postpones the celebration. This is one of the things I didn't realize till much later in my life. We just didn't celebrate much in our home. And as we were talking yesterday, some about just the spirit of celebration that lives in Anne and that she's introduced in our home. It's just been so, so wonderful. And I think that this is important in all discipline, is that we're not disciplined. Nothing's going to brood. It's not going to linger. It's not going to be forgiveness is for sure. We don't bring it back up, right? We're choosing the proper discipline at this moment, and it's for the purpose of correction and relationship and intimacy, and then we're going to continue to celebrate. You don't have to spend a long time working your way out of the doghouse before you can be celebrated again.
God forgives us, and the word says he remembers our sin no more. So if you want to model the way God forgives, he remembers it no more. So you don't bring it back up, and you don't say, well, you remember, you know, or you don't make them pay, you know, later that day. You're just a little disgusted with them because of what they put you through that afternoon. God forgives, and he remembers our sin no more. So you want to keep a short account. You want to deal with it in the moment. This is hard, and it takes some time, but you want to deal with it, and you want to move on.
I was preaching recently on Psalm 25 and landed upon something I'd never noticed before. It's just so gorgeous. Psalm 25:7, it's attributed to David. He says, "Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me." Mm-hmm. And this is fulfilled in Jesus, this prayer, that the Lord would remember not our sins, but instead he'd remember us. In his covenantal love, he remembers us. He set his love upon us. He doesn't remember your sin, he remembers you. And this is what, when we have healthy discipline, we're doing. We're not remembering your sin. Our kids are going to sin. We're all going to mess up. That's not when I look at you, that's not what I see. When God looks at you, he doesn't see your sin. Gone. He sees you. Okay. Fifthly, this point of moving to celebration is assuring you're still celebrated in this home. You're still loved in this home. So these subpoints: healthy discipline creates the assurance in the child's heart, though I'm not perfect, I'm celebrated, so I must be valuable. Rather than, the reason I'm not celebrated is because I've messed up so much, so I must not be valuable. Never want our kids to think, I've messed up so much that I'm no longer celebrated in this home. I'm not really even wanted here, right? That would just make a kid want to pull away. The second subpoint here: healthy discipline creates the assurance in the child's heart, I am valued enough to be trained, rather than I'm not valuable because I have messed up. In discipline, if you care about somebody, you want to help them find a better way. And so you're turning on the light for them. Dudley Hall, in his book Grace Works, tells this and gives this analogy, that if you walk into a dark room, bump into a piece of furniture, imagine a voice comes in and says, "Don't bump into the furniture, you fool." And it stays dark. You take another couple steps, you bump your shin again, ow, I told you to quit bumping into the furniture, what a fool you are. And it stays dark. That's shame. But imagine you go into a room, you bump into a piece, it's dark, you bump into a piece of furniture, you go, ouch. And then a light turns on and says, ah, no need to bump into furniture anymore. Let me turn the light on. You can see where you're going now. That's the conviction of the Holy Spirit. A light turns on. That hurt. That's not the right way. Let me shed some light on this for you. And I think children pick up on this. Children want to be disciplined. I know that sounds crazy. They do. They do. My dad was at home till I was in fourth grade. He really never disciplined me. I think that he wanted to show me something of acceptance, and he never really disciplined me. It was really my mom that did, and then dad was gone. So I didn't have those moments of instruction. And I really wanted that. I might not have been able to say as a kid that I wanted that. I wanted that thing that a father and son get, was like refining that happens when there's some butting of heads and there's some stuff that's going on and some wrestling. And I wanted that. Our children, they need it. They want the discipline. If you look on page 16, I've drawn up a couple of images here that just to give you a little picture. Jesus, the Bible says, came full of grace and truth. He was not 50% grace and 50% truth. He was 100% grace at all times and 100% truth at all times. If we could be this as parents, it would be revolutionary. The problem with most of us is that I've got days where I feel like, man, I'm full of grace. And, you know, you're messing up, but I'm all right, you know, that, and it doesn't bother me too much today. And then other times, like, man, I'm so full of truth, I'm going to lay some truth on you, and I don't have much grace to show you right now. Jesus wasn't this way. He was always 100% full of grace and always 100% full of truth, which meant that he was never excusing sin, and he was never leading somebody into deception, and he was always merciful and always gracious. And this is why sinners love to be around Jesus. He didn't become known as the friend of sinners because he just overlooked sin. No, he didn't. And people knew the truth sets you free, that there was truth in this man, but there was something different about him that was not like the other religious leaders. And so I think the goal here is to have grace and truth. And so if you kind of look at these as two continuums, and you can see how there can be different types of parents. If there's a bunch of grace, but low on the truth side, then you're in that upper left, and that's where everything, you're very permissive. If you've got very little truth and very little grace, it just means you're just not really there. You've kind of checked out, and that's passive. If you've got lots and lots of truth, but very little grace, then you're going to probably be running your home like a military sergeant and be very punitive. But the goal is the upper right, which I just call the prosperous parent, where you have grace and truth, then the child's going to prosper in that environment. Look at the next page. Here's another way to look at what the fruit is produced in the child. There's lots of grace, but very little truth. The child might feel affection, but it's going to be really confused. Really confused. Who am I? What am I supposed to do with my life? Why was that behavior not corrected? Is it just okay to do that? What all that? But if there's very little grace and very little truth, that child is neglected, abandoned, is left from the passive parent, left just feeling wounded. If there's lots and lots of truth, we're going to tell you, and we'll give you a bunch of Bible verses, tell you everything you need to do, but there's very little grace, very little affection, that child is going to produce distance. It's going to be like the, it's going to be like the older brother out in the field. But the healthy child is where there's grace and there's truth. One more example, this is the next page, the child's character. Where there's lots of grace but very little truth, then the child is loved but untrained. If there's very little grace and very little truth, then the child's unloved and untrained. That's the neglected child. That's the orphaned child. Lots of truth, little grace, trained but unloved. But what we're going for is loved and trained. So discipline is an expression of love, and it's an expression of truth. And we want to incorporate both grace and truth. Well, let's just talk about some of the tips and make this as practical as we can. Some of the tips for disciplining from a good news perspective. Major on the majors. And this means lots of yeses, and you make the no's guilt-free for the parent and more powerful and acceptable to the child when you have lots and lots of yeses. And this has been something I'm so thankful you established in our house. I probably wouldn't have known how to do this, but you built it into a yes house. And say a little bit more about building a yes house.
Well, and we talked about this yesterday, that it's important to have lots of yeses. Just have lots of yeses. And to be very thoughtful about your no's. And that's where wisdom comes in, because there's some things that you'll agree to that you'll be surprised that you agreed to. You'll think, well, is this worth the battle? And sometimes the answer is no. You let it go. Years and years ago, long before we had children, Alan was serving as senior pastor at a church, and we were driving home. We hadn't been married too long. And there was a young man that attended our church. He was in early 20s. And he was walking down the road. He was walking home from church. And he had hair down his back. I mean, you know, down below his waist. And he had it pulled up in a ponytail. And we drove past him, and, you know, we waved. And I said to Alan, I said, if we ever have a son, are you going to let him wear his hair like that? And Alan said, if I ever have a son that has the character of that young man, we said his name, he can wear his hair any way he wants. And I something went into me in that conversation, changed me. I never forgot it. And I live by that rule of thumb. You know, it doesn't matter how you wear your hair. It does not matter what you put on. And I have, you know, two teenagers, and it's interesting what they will put on their bodies. Does, and we're the pastor. I want you on a Sunday morning to look pretty good, and we come out with some interesting things. I'm all about character. I know the character of my children. I do not want to be about appearance. I do not want to be about appearance. I want my children to understand that. What matters to me is what's on the inside of them, not what's on the outside of them. So you have to choose your battles. And if that's really a challenge for you, it's important to get with God and say, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. God, do a work in me right now if I'm majoring on the wrong things, because I want to major on the right things, and there'll be only a few of those. We want to have a yes house.
Major on the majors, and as Anna's been sharing, then when the no's come, they're more significant. The best discipline really requires little words in action. And this has a lot to do with establishing authority from very earliest times as our children are young. As we've talked about, we do a lot of self-definition. I'd say the majority of our discipline has been simple as this: we don't do that. And you got to get the right look for the "we don't do that." Because it's not a look that says, "I'm disgusted with you and I don't like you." It's a look that says, "You're a lot better than that. We don't do that." It's a look that says, "We're not going to do that. I'm making that very clear right now. We don't do that." I'm just telling you, if every parent could get "we don't do that," other people might do that. I can't control other people, but I am telling you what we're going to do in this household.
And that's very important, because I think every parent will deal with a time where your child will say, "Well, Susie does this. The Johnsons do this. I was just over at their house, and they were," you know, you get this comparison thing going. And she, you know, "Well, so, you know," Alan will sometimes, he would sometimes say to me, "And you're the adult." Because I would get into a discussion about it. You know, we'd have a discussion about, no. I'm not speaking about the Johnsons. They do things in their household the way they feel is right. I'm going to tell you about the Wright household, the W-R-I-G-H-T. But, you know, it kind of comes out good, right? Right? We got it? We got the Wright household. Well, we got it coming and going. I married Mr. Wright. Saying. We got it in every direction. I'll tell you about the Wright household. This is where our bar is. Somebody sets the bar in your home. This is where the bar is.
Yeah.
And in some homes, the children set the bar.
And
here's who should set the bar. You set the bar. This is where the bar is in our household.
And you're not going, don't exasperate your children by making the bar be over the little things that don't matter.
Yeah.
Make it on the big things that do matter, the little things, the things that families squabble about. Sometimes I look, I'm like, I just feel like most families would do much better to have a giant sign over the door that says, "Lighten up. This too will pass." This is not that big of a deal. When there are big deal things, the bar is strong. Okay. So we were talking about our beagle, and one day I get a call. I'm at the office, and it's Abby. She's little. She's screaming on the phone. I can barely understand what she's saying. Reese's in the backyard. He's trapped a possum, and the possum's attacking him, and we can't get him to come out. And I was like, I'm on my way home. And I said, well, I was going to go back there. I was going to get the hose, and I was going to spray down the possum, because a possum can tear you up. And they get backed in the corner, and
it was dark.
Was it a possum or a raccoon?
It was a possum.
That thing
hissing.
It's a possum. This is beyond playing dead. It was cornered, and it's just biting and clawing at him, and Reese and everything, and nobody could get him come out. And I said, okay, first thing I'm going to do is everybody, Reese, come on, Reese. And nothing happened. I was going to get the hose. I was going to do something. But first, when I went over, I said, "Reese, come here. Reese." And the dog came, turned and trotted out of the woods.
It just came right out.
And I just said, it just proven I am the alpha dog. And you got to be the alpha dog, you know, because I'm just saying that the most important thing in discipline is to establish the fact, you don't have to hurt a child or beat a child. I am the authority here. And we're, most of our discipline has been just as simple as that. We don't do that. We're not going to do that. I won't let you do that, because that's not who we are. So very little words or action are really, really needed. If you're having to spank all the time, discipline all the time, everything else, then that's not the goal. Third, lavish forgiveness. We never withhold forgiveness. We talked about these things. Also, no penance, no implication you have to do something to earn back my love. And as Anne has been making this point, see discipline not as a necessary evil, but as a high calling of teaching your children. Big doses of their love language before and after discipline is something Gary Chaplin taught me. And this, Bennett loves quality time. He doesn't value gifts. Abby loves, she loves gifts. But so that meant with Bennett, if there's going to be discipline, I knew some quality time with him before, and I'm going to have quality time afterwards. Every time I've disciplined Bennett, I knew afterwards, what we're going to do? What do you want to do, Bennett? You want to go have some fun? I know that's hard because sometimes you're busy. You don't have time to do that. That's a tough one. But it's communicating. I want to be with you.
Yeah, it's... Correct discipline takes time.
It does.
So if you are stressed to the max, two parents stressed to the max, it's very, very, very difficult to discipline correctly because it takes time. You've got to have margin in your life, and you've got to structure your lives so that at least one of you has some margin. Because it takes time. Even if none of your children, their love language is quality time, to stop in the moment and deal with whatever it is takes time.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody has got to have time to do that. If you don't have time to do that, you don't have time to train up your children in the way they should go.
This is big because... what I think we're trying to say is if you discipline well, especially early on, you won't have to discipline very often.
Yeah.
And I know some of you, you know, we get this many parents together. Some of you got some kids you're having a really tough time with, and maybe we'll get some questions and we could address some specific things. Because sometimes you look at it and you go, oh, man, I'm playing catch up. I wish I'd established a little bit more authority early on. But even if there's never a better time than right now to try to administer a kind of discipline that is instilling identity, instilling value. And because once it starts working, there's going to be less discipline in the future. It's better, even though it's momentarily painful to have to take that much time to do it well, to do it well. So love languages, I think it's a great thing. If you're not familiar with Gary Chapman's work on that, you can get his books on it. And this next one is important, that the language that you use for discipline, as we are saying, you want it to fit everything else we've been talking about for these 2 days. It would obviously be nonsensical to spend your parenting to build your child's sense of blessedness, self-acceptance and love, and a sense of being an heir with a positive identity, to only tear it down during discipline. So I think it's just really important as parents, we know, let's admit it, we're going to get frustrated, we're going to get angry times. We got to train ourselves on what do I do in those moments. And what's helped me a lot is just I've gotten myself where I am absolutely positive that curse is destructive and blessing is builds up a child in a spiritual way. And I want to do what works. And so I've just tried to find some things, like we talked about, what Ann said. God gave you a good brain. I expect you to use it. That's not who you are. This is who God made you to be. If I'm really, really frustrated, and I would say that because of this and this training, there really has not been a time in which, even when I've been, and I've had some low moments as a parent where I've been really mad, but even in those moments I was really mad, what came out of my mouth was not curse. And I think you can train yourself in this. You give yourself some language. So you just resolve right now. I don't care how mad I get. I'm going to let my words be words that are consistent in the direction of who I want the child to be. Here's a simple rule of thumb. Never announce to your child the very thing you don't want your child to be. Announce to your child who you want them to be, right? So you, I don't, if a kid's being selfish, I don't want him to be selfish. So I don't announce, you're selfish, right? And said, you're not a selfish kid. That's not who you're destined to be. And that thing you just did right there was selfish, and that doesn't fit who you are. And we're not going to have that. You see, that's where so be angry, but do not sin. All right. And that means, A, if you're one of those and you got to have a cooling off before you say anything, you need to get that cooling off. But train yourself that when you are frustrated, it's okay that our kids see that we're frustrated. What's not okay is for, in our frustration, for us to curse them with doom statements that alienate our relationship with them. Even in our frustration, we want to express to them everything we've been saying about discipline. I want you close to me. I want you with me. Okay. So our language is really, really important. And obviously what we're trying to communicate here is avoiding any kind of shaming type discipline. As I mentioned earlier, certain forms of sending a child away, get away from me, I can't even stand to see you. Name calling, comparing the child to another is particularly destructive. Maybe we might come back to this a little bit later, but I think it's particularly destructive because we don't want to instill a covetous spirit or a jealous spirit in our children, because that's like a poison. And so comparing to another child is diabolical, because what it's saying is, if you would be more like this child, I would love you more. And that's just destructive to the child's spirit. I would say never using religious threats or implying that God won't approve of them. Please don't use the Word of God, which is from the opening page to the final page, a good news story of the redemption that God brought through the miraculous rescue that came with Jesus Christ, who set His love upon us, died upon a cross while we didn't deserve it, so that we could be attributed as having become His righteousness and being highly favored and blessed with every spiritual and blessing because of this finished work of Jesus Christ. Please don't diminish this big, great, magnificent story to a few moralisms that you spout off to your children with religious sayings. Did that come across kind of strong? But I really think we do a lot of damage. The kid that grows up in a religiously legalistic home has a particularly hard time. Why? Because the first place, those religious moralisms don't work. It doesn't work to assign a Bible verse and say you ought to be more like this because the Bible says so. There is something much richer that's taking place through a relationship with our kids, that we lead them into a relationship with Jesus Christ such that they have the Holy Spirit within them, shaping identity, all these things we've been saying. And certainly this means, therefore, to not use the Bible as a means to threaten them with God's disapproval. And it's like parents get desperate and they want to bring God into this equation because they haven't been able to find a way to instill identity in their child. Don't do that, because we want our children to know that God's a good father. God loves them. God is never, ever turning away from them in disgust. He came to them in the person of Jesus. We want them to know who God really, really is. And I mean, the most severe case of this is a lady in our church that for years, She's been asking for prayer that she could just experience and know the love of God. And she's still having terrible struggle with this. And it all goes back to this. In her upbringing, there was a little figurine of Jesus in her home. And her mother, when she would disobey, her mother would say, "If you keep doing that, then baby Jesus is going to get you." And she can't get past this because this was just gone. Now, most of us, thankfully, never had somebody saying, "Baby Jesus is going to get you." But we do it in more subtle ways using more sophisticated scriptures than that. That's not what we want to do. So don't use religious language that implies God won't approve of him. Nothing in our discipline do we want to be instilling fear. That's not what we're going for. We want faith in our kids and no cursing. No, your life isn't going to turn out well because of your disobedience. That is absolutely what we don't want to say to them. We absolutely don't want to say, "Well, you're a mess up and now your life's just all messed up." No, you have a wonderful destiny and a wonderful future. You might have been running contrary to it right now, and that's why we're disciplining this behavior. Also, along with this is not embarrassing them. To not shame means we don't embarrass. Be a very, very, very rare instance where we would have some sort of discipline that would take place in front of others. When you discipline, show honor to your children. Right? I cannot believe how many I'll see in public places, parents that are humiliating their children. Their form of discipline is to humiliate their children in public. That's the very opposite of what we want to accomplish. It's just honor them in all of your actions towards them, right?
You're wanting to communicate that they are valuable. You're wanting to communicate that
yes.
they are valuable.
Yes.
So in every instance, you want to communicate, "You are so valuable, I wouldn't want to dishonor you."
I'm not going to treat
in the grocery store.
I'm not going to treat that.
You may
like
have to leave your cart with your ice cream and leave the grocery store. Whatever it is, you deal with it, and you deal with it quickly, and you don't do it in any way. Parents do this regularly because that shame, that humiliation, they think if I humiliate this child, they're not thinking this consciously.
Right.
But they know if they humiliate the child won't do it again.
Yeah.
We'll make it sting so bad that this will, and it might curb for a short while. It's not an eternal change, but it might curb for a short while that actual behavior. But the good stuff that you had the opportunity to sow in that moment, the love and the honor and the value, is all lost.
Everything that is important and imperative of blessing, loving, honoring our children and building a home like that applies in the midst of discipline just as much, if not more so. So we can't chunk all that out because now we're going to discipline and they're going to be humane. Number nine tip here is really basically, here's the rule. Only use the amount of discipline necessary to bring the child to the conviction of sin and repentance. I think this is the way God is with us also. If you operate according to a punishment mentality, then okay, this crime deserves 30 years in prison, right? So you got to give the amount. That's not what's happening in the parental discipline relationship with the child. What we're really trying to do is just teach the child. So once you learn, you learn. Once you learn, you learn. You don't have to keep on. Once somebody's learned something, you got to keep disciplining them for something that they've learned. Right. So only amount that's needed. You know, I mentioned briefly, you know, there are different feelings about spanking. Here's what I would just say about it. I think it's okay. But if you're spanking a whole lot or if you're spanking when you're angry, you shouldn't spank. Because this is an issue. If you tend to be one of those angry kind of people, you probably need to stay away from this one. And if you strike a child with anything other than a really controlled, mild kind of strike the child's bottom, then something's wrong and you need to look for other forms of discipline and maybe, you know, do some real counsel with that about anger issues. But the bottom line to this is that I think that good discipline means you don't have to have lots of discipline. And it's more of ineffective discipline that just happens over and over, where then you become the Charlie Brown teacher. Womp, 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 womp. You know, it just doesn't mean anything anymore, right? So I'm just in favor of less that is thoughtful, but it's effective, it's thoughtful, it's producing the results. And then a final tip here is just avoiding threats and repeated threats. Threats are either parents' unwillingness to actually discipline, or it's an attempt to keep the child in fear, and both of those are bad. Both of them are bad. You know, so if you do that again, I'm going to, you know, you're going to blah, blah, blah. I just, I mean, it's okay to say, I want to give you an understanding of what the consequence is going to be here. But once you've made that a child aware of that, what the consequence is going to be, which I think that's important, because you don't want to be flighty, inconsistent, and just cruel. You just, that's not acceptable, and there's going to be such and such consequence if you do that. And if it does, you just got to, I mean, this, everybody, every parent knows this, you just got to go ahead and follow through on that. Because otherwise, you're just trying to keep the child in a mode of the looming possibility, which is creating anxiety. Well, you see here some of the just best language kind of tips that we've just, we wrote these down because we heard ourselves saying these things. God gave you a good brain, I expect to use it. We don't do that. We've talked about that. You're a good kid. God's got great purposes for you. When you did that, it didn't match up to who you are. A lot of, you're not a selfish child. You're not a mean child. You're not a whiner. You're not a dishonest child. That's why we don't allow selfishness. A lot of I love you. There's nothing you could ever do to make me stop loving you. This discipline doesn't mean I love you less. It means I love you so much. I want you to learn a better way. Language like that. So let's pause here and see. I'm sure there's some questions about discipline. We'll take just a few because we still got a few things we want to say about the power of hope. So, but important questions here. Anything about discipline? Yeah.
Just invite us in on what were some of the majors? Like, you know, all of us left here last night and we got ice cream and donuts. And
the important stuff.
Just knows from like check my kids out to the other. They wanted a sleepover. They wanted a party. You know,
yeah.
Right.
When Abigail was 3 years old, I caught her in a total lie. She we were on vacation. She went, Bennett was reading a book or something. She was three, maybe four, maybe, but she was little. And I heard her in there. I was working on a book. I was writing. We were all just doing different things. It was one of the times she was just lonely and she wanted somebody to play with her. So she went to try to get Bennett and he said, no, I'm reading right now. I'm doing something. And so I heard her go downstairs and say, Mom, Bennett won't play with me. And Ann said, well, you can't always get him to do what you want. You know, you're going to need to find something else to do right now, and he'll play with you maybe later or something like that. She walked up the stairs. I heard this whole thing. She walked up and she said, Bennett, Mom said you need to play with me right now. When they're three, it's cute, but this was my thing. I'd much rather deal with lying now than when she's 13. So I didn't want to stop what I was doing. I got right up. I went in. I said, Abby, I just heard you tell a lie. I said, now we need to talk about this. And two things. She loved this little bracelet that she'd gotten from the bubblegum machine or something. I don't know, but she loved it. I said, two things. I said, I'm taking that bracelet away from you for a little bit. I said, second thing, you need to apologize to your brother. And I made her, this was the part I think she hated the most. I said, you need to say, Bennett, I'm sorry that I lied. She didn't want to say that. She was willing to say, I'm sorry, but she didn't want to say, I'm sorry, I lied. She said, I'm sorry, sorry. That's what she said, sorry, sorry, Ben. I said, no, you need to say, I lied, I'm sorry. She just cried, said, I lied. I said, no, I'm going to take that bracelet from you. And then we just had lots of love on her and all of this. And that was major. And we explained everything that has to do with trust is built on telling the truth. I'm always going to tell you the truth. We're not going to do things right all the time. We're going to mess up. But we're going to tell the truth. That was major. Honoring yourself and honoring others, major in our family, because if it touches upon self-identity, negative self-talk, self-cursing or cursing others, major to us. The things that had to do, I think, about whining, it wasn't so much about we're just bothered by the what was important to us is that if we whine, it means we don't think we're blessed, and we are so blessed. Look at how blessed we are. And so knowing ourselves blessed, that was major to us. What else would you say were major?
Well, and I would say with the Abby, the lying, it was deceit. Any kind of deceit. You know, you can tell somebody something and it's basically the truth, but you're deceiving them. You can deceive. You can leave out some facts. You want to mislead somebody. We have an enemy and he traffics in the darkness. So we want to always stay in the light. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship. That's what the word says. So we want to stay in the light. And I taught my kids, you always want to stay in the light. So we're going to be open. We're going to share with you. We're going to always be honest. And I want you to always be honest with me. And I want you to share with me. And we're going to talk about everything. We're going to stay in the light. Because as long as you're in the light, you're where you're supposed to be. We're not going to step over into the darkness because we have an enemy. And when they were old enough to understand that the enemy traffics in the darkness. And he can't come into the light. So we're going to stay in the light. So deceit was a form of stepping over into the darkness. And we weren't gonna do that. So that was just not an option. I wanted my children to understand why we had. If you have a rule in your house, as soon as they can understand it,
yeah.
You need to help them understand why you have the rule and why it's beneficial to them.
Why are we majoring on this? Another thing that's good about that is if you couldn't explain to your child why we're majoring on this, it's probably because it shouldn't have been majored on.
Right.
Yeah.
If there isn't any benefit, then why were we making a big deal of it?
All right. Other discipline, any other discipline? Yeah.
Well, I kind of piggyback on this, on the line. We have two kids 2 years apart, and it's one of them something happened that you did not see it happen, and you're getting
two stories.
And the younger one, maybe you are pretty sure this didn't happen, but they won't own up to it. And
yeah.
You oh, God. Let's take a break
they
now.
They can't both be telling the truth. I know.
I think communication, if I were to say one thing that was important in your household, it's communication. It's communication in your marriage, communication in your parenting. So it's important to sit down with the one who has erred and say, tell me what you remember. Tell me what you thought went on. And say now, whatever the other story is. This is what Sue says happened. But I want to believe you. And so I would give the benefit of the doubt to the one who's erred and say, but I would say we want to walk in the light. And as he is in the light, we want to stay in the light. So I want you to always be honest with me. I want you to understand you can always be honest with me. You can always be honest with me. And we're going to deal with it together. And so I think on a first offense like that, I would give the benefit of the doubt. And I would say, you know, I would say to my older child who says, you can say, you know, this time we're just going to give her the benefit of the doubt because I wasn't there to see it. And we're going to walk in grace. Does that make sense?
And you're putting a greater value on you are free to talk to me. There's a greater value on that than me getting this exactly right to punish the right person right now. Whatever. It's there's something bigger than this.
The relationship.
Yeah,
it's always at the. You want to say how because God's always drawing us towards Himself.
Yeah.
So how in this instance can I draw my child towards me? And that's hard in discipline because you're wanting to do the very thing that you everything in you is often not causing you to do. You're wanting to, you know, you often do feel like you want to be separated, So it's an opportunity to walk at a level of godliness that you don't have.
Yeah.
That opportunity often.
Yeah. Okay.
talking about grace and repentance and penance and all the differences in the two. So often, you know, the age-old seminary debate about there can be no forgiveness without repentance. And so I want to know what you think about can there be forgiveness without repentance? And I'm not talking about shaming or conditions of acceptance, but the question is, should there be discipline? We teach them to ask for real forgiveness with repentance, and also, do we teach them how to properly ask for forgiveness?
Yeah.
I'm not saying I'm sorry, asking for forgiveness. So I want to know what you thought.
Right, right. Well, the question is, should there be forgiveness? Can there be forgiveness without repentance? And it's a deep theological question that many people have debated. If you don't repent, does God forgive you? Here's my basic feeling on this, that people have taken the 1 John passage, if we confess our sins, then he's faithful and just to forgive us. And pulled out really what is one verse of a limited discussion in the New Testament, and have made it seem as though if I haven't confessed my sin, then I'm not forgiven. And I just would say that that's completely illogical, because in the first place, I don't even know all my sin. There's no way I could know all my sin. It's also terrifying to think that if I had sinned and I didn't confess and I walked and got hit by a bus, I wasn't forgiven for that sin. So I think it's theologically illogical. And I also think it's contrary to the nature of the gospel itself, because everything in the gospel is about this lavish forgiveness that God has poured out upon us. And it's really like his love. It's so much more a matter of accepting and receiving the love that he's already offered us in Christ. So I tend to believe it's more like this, that there's lavish forgiveness that has been offered in Christ through the sacrifice of Christ, and that part of our sanctification is increasingly accepting that. I think that Christians are on the whole far too bent towards morbid brooding over their sin instead of a passionate brooding over the lavish love of God, which actually transforms us. So how does that relate in parenting? I would say that I'd like to be towards my kids more the way God is towards me. And we never really made it a practice to say, we're not going to forgive you unless you ask for forgiveness. To me, it starts feeling like a work, and it starts feeling like something that is sort of rote. And also, I don't even know all the things that my kids have done that are wrong. It's kind of fun now. You know, I thought my kids were more perfect than they were, but now they're kind of grown up and they're come out and tell me some things, you know. And I'm like, are you kidding? I didn't even know about that. So I lived in a posture of forgiveness towards them. Now, where there is in the body of Christ an unrepentant sin, which is saying in the face of God, I know that you say this is wrong, but I don't care. I'm going to do what I want to do. That creates a distance from God, and it is utterly displeasing and hurtful to the heart of God. And I think in that, to the Christian I'm speaking of now, okay? To the Christian, the one who's in Christ, I think what it does is not make the Lord go, well, I just don't forgive you of that sin. But I think what it does is it makes the Christian be blocked from receiving and walking in the fullness of relationship with God, because I'm not receiving the benefits of the cross of Jesus Christ right now. So that's a little subtle take on that. But I think that because of that, my parenting style would have been leaning more towards, now in that instance with Abby, I wanted her to say a direct apology and learn how to apologize. It is important to learn how to apologize. But is that a prerequisite to be forgiven? It feels a little bit like saying it's a prerequisite to being loved. And so that's my take on that. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, honey. It's a great question.
Our goal is repentance. You want your child to change their mind, to change their way of thinking, and that will change the behavior. So there are instances where you discipline and And you will have wisdom as a parent. You'll think, I don't know that there's that full mind change and heart change has happened in this instance. And we may deal with this again. Does that make sense? We're going to probably, until you see that, we would see it with Abby because she would burst into tears and be so sorry and so repentant on something that you wouldn't even discipline. You found yourself, your discipline, where Abby was saying, it's okay, it's okay. That's kind of the way you disciplined her when she truly repented. There was such a change in her. So sometimes it's, we're training our children.
Yeah.
We're training them, and just like in any training exercise, you have to work that muscle, and you have to work it, and you got to work it, and you got to work it before you actually get it. We're doing that with our children, and sometimes it's once, but sometimes it takes more than once, and parents will get weary of that. And it's not that you're. Sometimes it is, but it's not always that you're ineffective. It's just that it takes more than once to really train them and for there to be true repentance, a true changing of their minds.
Yeah.
A reordering of their thinking.
Yeah. Let me just, we're out of time, and which is fine with us because we, you know, the conversation with you guys is what we're most interested in. And it's been such a wonderful delight to be with you. We just love being able to interact with parents that are still in the midst of raising their kids. And thank you so much for coming. The last goal that I'll only mention here has to do with hope. And I think for a long time in my Christian life, I gave short shrift to hope. I didn't understand its power. But what hope is in our children is, it's not wishful thinking. It's not like the child who says, I wish I'd get a pony for Christmas, when she really means, I know I probably won't get a pony. That's just wishful thinking. But it's more like a child before Christmas who's all excited, and you say, why are you so excited? And the child says, because I know Christmas is coming. That's hope biblically. Hope is an inward attitude of delight and expectancy that you're convinced that the future is good. And what happens is the younger son, when he leaves home, he has hopelessness. I don't have a good future here at home, so I'm going to rebel. But when he returns, hope has returned to him. The older son is slaving because of hopelessness. And yet the whole point of the story for both these boys is, can't you see you have a wonderful future because you're heirs of this estate? When you have a sense of a future blessing, it makes you aware of your blessedness now. Years ago, Bennett was going to get he wanted some new golf clubs for his birthday, and it was time for him to get a new set away from junior clubs, his first real set. And so we went down to the golf store, and we tested clubs, looked to the simulator and everything. We found the exact clubs that were going to be his clubs. And his birthday was a couple weeks away. He didn't watch me buy them. He didn't know for sure I bought them, but I mean, he knew. And so during this period of time of this 2 weeks, he didn't have the golf clubs. He just had the hope of the golf clubs. But the hope that he had was as if he already had the real thing. That's how powerful hope is. We have hope as an anchor to our souls, Hebrews says. It's like, I may not have everything of heaven now, but I've tasted of the hope of glory. And so we live in this hope. And Paul says in Romans, hope does not put us to shame. Hope does not disappoint us. Hope will never let you down. Hope energizes and motivates our children. Years ago, during one of the Olympics, the downhill skiers, Julio Mancuso, who'd won a gold medal that year, and they told a cute story about her. When she was a little girl, she had drawn a picture of herself skiing down a mountain on the way to winning a gold medal, and she kept it up on her wall. Now, you might say, well, if Julia Mancuso thought that she was going to win a gold medal, then what did that mean? She just, you know, the more certain she was that she could win a gold medal, the lazier she got? No, of course not. What it meant was she was so certain she could win a gold medal that she went out into the gym and worked out every day, and she went skiing every day and practiced every day of her life until she eventually made the Olympics. What I'm saying is hope doesn't make us lazy. Hope energizes us towards a goal. the more certain is that we have a positive future, the more we are likely to move towards it with energy. And so everything we've been saying in terms of how do your children become motivated, how do you end up having high expectations in kids without them feeling pressure and shame, it's a process that's taken place that's built hope into their hearts. They envision their life going somewhere. They envision it, they see it, they taste it. And all that we've been saying is leading up to this. I'm on page 23. Talk about seasons. You know, sometimes there's like a winter time, and it doesn't mean spring's not coming. Spring's coming. Dan's good about it. Talks about seasons. Speak regularly and plan future events. We're out of time, but if we have more time, Anne would tell you about how she's built traditions in our home, because fun traditions build a sense of there's good things that are coming in my life. They don't have to be expensive. They don't have to be elaborate, but they have to be reliable. And speak destiny into your children's hearts. When John Wesley, the famous founder of Methodism and the revivalist who really God used to change the world, when he was a little boy, that their house burned down and he was trapped in it. And it looked like he was certainly going to perish. But instead, someone went in and rescued him from all of the burning rafters that were falling down around him and rescued him. And his mother, Susanna, woman of God, she told him from that day forward, "You are my brand plucked from the burning. God has great purposes for you." I didn't come across as pressure. That came across as destiny. There's a big difference between hope and pressure. Pressure means you're going to be loved less if you don't excel. Hope means I already feel good about myself and I'm going to make a difference in this world. Everybody that's trying hard is either doing so because they don't feel good about themselves and they're trying to prove themselves worthy, or because they are already fulfilled inwardly and they want to make a difference. And what I'm just saying is that God can use you as the primary authorities and His spokespeople to speak this hope into your children. And that hope will anchor them in life. Okay. Father, we thank you so much for the time we've had together, and we thank you for the astounding hope that you have put into our hearts. We're thankful for the hope of glory that lives in us as your own beloved. I'm thankful, Father, for every parent here, every person here, every grandparent here, for every prospective parent that's here, for each and every one uniquely right in this moment, Lord. I pray for the blessed presence of the Holy Spirit that gives hope to each one, hope in our parenting, hope for our lives. Father, we thank you that you have plans for us, and it is not to harm us, but to give us a future and a hope. And Lord, we've been talking a lot about teaching our kids, and I pray now for myself and for each one of us, teach us, Lord. We are glad learners, glad to be disciples that are being carried along on the path of learning. And we pray, Father, that you continue to instill wisdom within us. Lord, I bless these parents in the mighty and precious name of the Lord Jesus. And I say to each one of you, child of God, you have in you, deposited within you, an earnest that guarantees your own inheritance. You have the very presence of the Spirit of Jesus within you. I say with John in his epistle, you have an anointing, and that anointing of the Holy Spirit will lead you into truth. You can make wise decisions. You can hear from God, and you can teach your children the way of prosperity for their souls, for their lives. And we bless you and we thank God and ask, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus, for the encouragement of the Holy Spirit who comes alongside and whispers every reassurance that you're with us, you're never going to leave us, never forsake us, and you'll carry us all the way through. And we give you all the praise, honor, and glory in the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.
Amen.